There we are, 6:30. So we're going to do, so this year we've gone through and we took votes as far as what classes people wanted to take. And this one, they decided they want to do redo the be a web search guru class. Basically how to search things on the internet. You ever been really frustrated? Maybe you've got a project you're trying to do and you want to know what, you know, this part does or how to purchase another one of those tools. So this is how we go through and we try and find out what's credible, what is, you know, an acceptable place to buy things, and how to use Google Voice, and all sorts of different little tips and tricks. We've got a lot of slides to pop through. At some point, I will ask for questions if anybody has any. And this is recorded. This is the state. We'll put it up on their webpage later on, probably by the 18th or so, at that link there at kslib.info/digital literacy. And you can go back through and you can watch if there's anything I go through so fast that maybe you have questions, maybe you go back through. But I'm also always available. At the very end, it'll have our email address and our Facebook page and everything else, you know, in case you have concerns about different things that, you know, I discussed here, and be happy to talk about them. All right. As always, the views and opinions are my own, not those of the public library, the county, the city, the state, whatever. There's a lot of reasons. These are the slides. I call them my boilerplate statements. I always want to start all my presentations by saying that there's reasons why you want to go to your local library, right? There's a physical location, usually within walking distance of most cities. There's human assistance of training, the things that maybe wheels think of that maybe you won't when you're searching for a specific topic. Having another noggin in the process is always helpful when you're trying to work something through. And robust content, as in we have more than just Google. We have more than just Facebook. We have access to white pages that we pay for content, and everybody has access to it through your library card. And so there's definitely reasons why you want to come to your library when you're doing any sort of research. Before you do any sort of research, please do your Windows updates or your spamware updates, your antivirus updates, firewall updates. Update everything before you go out on the internet searching for information, because it's hard to say what's credible. And so until you actually get to it. So please do all your updates. The illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read or write, but those cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. I think that's still true. There's some books that you can do to do research here at the public library. We've got the reconnaissance surveys, the census, the genealogical biographies. We still have the room downstairs. We don't have people have access to it because of COVID. But if you happen to know, and it's all in our card catalog. So if you find a book that you want, we can find a way to get it to you, whether it be, because some of them are so rare that we don't let them leave the building, but we have a photocopier. Sometimes there's copyright laws we can work around for that. We've got access to Value Line. We've got the Wichita Business Journal Book of Lists to check out your business competitions and things like that. Six different kinds of reference materials. We've got dictionaries, thesauruses, encyclopedias, almanacs, periodicals, to where you can search for periodicals. Now most of them are online now. What do people search for on the internet? You've got the hot trends and hot YouTube searches. So when we look at what are the hot trends that people are looking for on the internet, let's see, that is not going to work for me right now. But google.com/trends/hot trends, and you get a list of the current things that people are searching for on the internet. We'll just skip over. What do people search for is kind of an article here by Business Trader Insider. And here's another one from business2community.com. And guess how I found those? I just, you know, searched around, used search engines. But they're good articles worth looking into later on. I think you've stumped me with that question. I think that's something you need to Google. You know, it's definitely the search engines and the search spiders have definitely done something that has not been available in the human history. You know, one of Google's main things is they want to have the world library. They want to be able to scan everything. And they got that close to that before the copyright law started taking hold. back with the Google Books stuff. So Google is the go-to search engine for most people on the internet. So it's popular. It's the most popular, in fact. It's the way most of us will talk about things like, I don't know the answer, just Google it. You won't believe what we found when we Googled your name. Relax, I'm just Googling the address right now. You know, it used to be we would Yahoo, right? We would do a Yahoo search. But the Google search engine became so much stronger than the Yahoo was that we've just kind of all switched over. Don't tell me you climbed all the way up here before trying to Google. Why would you Google yourself? You know, see what's out there about yourself. Potential employers will search you. And that's something that is part of our world now. So any sort of comments you made on the internet, any sort of forum you participated in, they're going to find that. So you're going to want to take control of your online presence now. Right now, there's a lot of people you can pay to do that, to where they will make a search bot that'll search for your name and delete things out, or you know, make it more friendly. That's what politicians do, pay somebody else to do it. So if you're looking to be in the public spotlight, that's one thing you can do to try and edit things out. Something I've done is the inside of Google News, you can set a search term. Like I said, when I first started working here, for anytime Newton Public Library come in sort of news article, that I get a pop-up that sends me a link to that article so that I can read more about it. Now, by and large, I tend to get a lot of articles about Newton, Massachusetts, but that's my fault for not being more specific in my searches. Yeah, I can go out. Yeah. So I can't explain. It's just a funny feeling like I'm being Googled. Yeah, your name's out there. There's no way around it. The world is small these days. Come on, Vince, Google yourself. See if you're really as deadly as you keep telling us. So that, you know, when kids down on the playground saying, you know, their uncle, the gangster, killed 18 people. You can find these things out now. You know, back in the day, we would just take it as common knowledge that a child once swallowed Pop Rocks and Coca-Cola and their head blew off. That's just what we accepted. Well, now you can Google it. 20 seconds later, you know exactly, you know, what that's really about. So a lot of the following slides are not exactly what Google looks like right now, because Google changes day to day. So but the idea is still there, to where if I tell you to search for advanced and you can change your search terms, it's in there somewhere. Just kind of look around. It might be slightly different looking, but they have total control. That's one of the things that we have here, is we have a world where we get it for free, which is great, and then we start relying on it. And that's dangerous, because they can change things at any moment to where it might not benefit us in the ways that we had been used to and banked on. So just option one, you know, you go on into Google, you just type in what you're searching for, and hit enter, and it may or may not come up. Option two, you can use your browser bar, which is, so many people don't know what a browser bar is, to where I will tell them to type https://www.newtonplks.org newtonplks.org is our webpage address. It's an address. It's like a house address. That's what you type in the address bar when you know exactly where you want to go. So the address bar is the big long white bar at the top of the screen. So it's the orange one off to the left. So that's the address bar. The search bar is off to the right where it says Google. So that's where you can type in, where is Newton Public Library? And it will come up with it. So sometimes in the address bar, you can type in, where is Newton Public Library? But then it's going to take you to a search engine. And that's one way to do it, but that's a search engine search. That's not an address bar address. It's like going to the post office and say, send this to my Uncle Henry. You know, you got to kind of trust things and go from there. But if you know Uncle Henry's address, you can just write that on the thing and be done. You can use the Google Search app. You can download the app inside of Android or Apple iOS, and then you can have the search through there. Some tips for searching better, you know, with the with our guru up over there. Keep it simple. The KISS principles, keep it simple, silly. Take suggestions as far as if you start typing in Honda high rev engine, as you type it, it's going to start giving you suggestions. Honda bicycle, Honda, you know, power supply. But as you keep typing in Honda high power, high rev engines, it's going to get more specific with the little search engine dropdown and stuff. So start watching it as you're typing, because it might actually come up with something that's better than what you thought you were wanting to type. You can exclude words. So if you're looking for the Newton Public Library on 720 Oak, you might not need to type in the whole thing. So exclude some words and see what happens. Type, search for exact phrases. You know, when you only want to get the Newton, Kansas Public Library, you do a search for the exact things. You can refine results by making sure you've got the right things typed in there. Maybe Newton with a silent PH in the middle is not what you're looking for. Search for stock quotes, weather reports, movie listings. I mean, it's all in there. Oh, keep it simple, silly. Instead of complete sentences, search for cat, comma, Newton, Kansas, instead of tabby cat with 18 claws on the 100 block of North Maple, Newton, Kansas, 67104. You know, you don't necessarily need that, and that might exclude some things that you really are interested in. Search for model train, comma, Newton, Kansas, instead of A-class model train enthusiast group with members age 30 or younger in North Newton, Kansas. So there's definitely things that you can do to get better searches that are more like what you really are looking for, or might give you ideas in the future. There's Boolean searches, to where you analyze the way that you're saying things, right? So you can use the and feature, like children and television, so that kind of retrieves records containing both words, Rogers and Hammerstein, children and poverty. You can use the or term, so television or television viewing, retrieves records containing either one or both terms, so 60s or 60s or 1960s, labor or labor, if you're British. Not, you can use the not term, so television, not movies. It excludes records containing the second term, so Caribbean, not Cuba, S1, not S2. So and or not are definitely Boolean operators that are some things you can put to work for you when you're doing your searches. So as you type, Google will make guesses as far as what you're searching for, and it may offer a better list of searches. So search Guru, right? And it says Guru Bani, Gurus Inc., Guru.info. As you type, it will give you suggestions. Try better search terms. So you may need to reconsider your search term if you're not finding what you're looking for, right? So for example, you can make them more specific by adding more keywords or different keywords altogether. George Bush quote, Bill Clinton quote, minus laughing, minus smiling. So you got George Bush and Bill Clinton, right? Not laughing, and George Bush and Bill Clinton not smiling, even though they kind of seem like they're smiling a little bit. So just examples of how you can do your searches different or better, right? Exclude words, you put the subtraction. So for a search of macaroni minus cheese, it will yield results containing the word macaroni but not cheese. Speaking of macaroni and cheese, I do so enjoy some, and I plan on sending my daughters off with a giant 180 servings macaroni and cheese when they go off to college. Tips to search better, exact phrases. So for example, you put the quotes in there so that free online children's games instead of just games, and it includes all those words, and it's going to give you a more exact search. You can kind of use options. So when you look on Google today, you might not see a button that says search terms, but you should be able to go to google.com/advanced search, and it'll be in there somewhere that'll give you these advanced features that we're about to go through and talk about here in just a little bit. So here's kind of where I got the above comments for GFC Learn Free. We're going to talk about that later. Let's go on to the advanced stuff where you click on more and you can have videos and blogs and flights and search tools. So you can do booking flights and finance and personal. And you can do a search based on the published date as far as when that web page was last edited, last 24 hours, last year. You know, for a lot of things didn't change over 2020, or things changed a lot depending on what you're searching for. When you do the verbatim search, you could find reading level. Verbatim's kind of not part of the advanced search anymore so much. But we've got Google Translate with the foreign languages translation, and it's gotten a lot stronger in the last few years. There's a dictionary tool to where you can find synonyms and antonyms and everything else. You go through, got Safe Search, and show a man a link, he'll forget about it. Teach him to search and you'll make him into a guru. When you click on the advanced search, you got things where you can query by region and time and format, you know, the PDFs versus the DOCs and all sorts of different file formats you can do a search for. User's rights, as far as whether it's by license or open to share. If you can search into your Google, into your personal web history, you can find all sorts of different things you might not want to know. But you just kind of go up to the settings and web history. You can find out, here's Tech Boomers. Tech Boomers is a way that it's a free way to learn all sorts of things. So techboomers.com is the website. You just do a search up there for, say, search, right? And it's an educational website that was designed by a son for his mother. Teach older adults or internet interested internet users, various websites and internet-based applications. We've got one for Facebook and Spotify and all sorts of different things. So I just did a search for online search, and these are all the different classes that came up. And so when you click on them, some of them are articles, some of them are full-fledged classes. Like, they almost feel like they're college level because they're so well thought out and so well designed. So that top one with this, for Google search is the one that seems most applicable to what we were teaching here. And so it goes to a web page called /b/Google search. And you've got chapters about Google search, review, settings, image search, video search, and tips. So they really go in detail. And you can go through and you can pick different parts of the course. Here is one that was, I felt that it was a little bit out of order, but it was a search on internet safety. So you can just choose which part you want to learn about today. You don't have to go through step by step, which is really handy because if you sign up for a college course, you're stuck there week by week going through their course the way they designed. And you, in the end, you may not actually learn what it was you went in there trying to learn. I've known people that took an accounting course and they came out of it learning a lot about general business, but had nothing to do about the business that they planned on starting or planned on working for. Here's a great link from Tech Boomers. That was a article about search tips. So Google has a little video. I'm gonna see if it works. Keith, I'm gonna go ahead and unmute you just so that you can tell me if you can hear it or not.
I've got to call the pool cleaners, write thank you notes for the gifts, apologize to the clown, buy cleaning supplies, email the Shetland Pony Stable.
That's funny. I should write that down. Okay, reply to that. Or that. Just gonna sit here.
The sky looks amazing. I look amazing. I should take a selfie.
I like this tape. This tape is dope. I should order some dope tape.
Of course I remember the code. It's 4452?
Authorities are being called.
4-4-5.
Stupid lights.
Sure, Jim. I'd love to circle back with some action items.
I really gotta break up with my boyfriend.
Bright lights. That's good. Yeah, I should record that.
I'm not doing it.
I'm not gonna do it.
I'm not gonna do it.
I'm not gonna do it.
I ain't doing it.
I'm not gonna do it.
Oh, hey, buddy. Are you gonna wake me up for my 9 a.m. meeting?
No way.
Did I forget to lock the front door? Hey, Google?
Hi. What can I do for you?
So just a Google search is not just...
I've got to call the pool cleaners. I've got to call the pool cleaners. Write thank you notes for the gifts. Apologize to the clown. Buy cleaning supplies. Email the Shetland Pony.
To where if, like, I've got a light bulb at home that interfaces with my Wi-Fi so that when I lay down in bed, I can tell Google to turn on and off the front porch, the bedroom light that's way over there that I can't quite reach. I don't want to reach because I'm already laid down. There's just a lot of things that are now built into Google that our world is becoming interconnected for. So you can do your searches now just by saying, okay, Google, search for white face masks. And it will do that for you. And it's really, you know what? Let's go ahead and let's do that. My phone's in the other room. I can't ask Google to get my phone because it's already in the other room. So, no, I'm going to do it. I'm just going to hop up and I'll be right back.
I don't know whether we're muted or not, so let's be careful.
See? Okay.
Yeah, we have this on ours now. Have you noticed that? It's sometimes down in the corner.
Oh, looks like you got unmuted. And so did you hear the video?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, we did.
Great. Okay. Did you have a question?
No, we're okay.
Okay. I'll go ahead and pop you on mute again. Okay. So this is my phone. And so I'm just going to go to the main home screen. And I'm going to say, okay, Google, find white face masks. So, searching for it, and sure enough, it found a bunch of white face masks. See if I can irritate my family at home. Okay, Google, turn off bedroom. Says, all right, it's turning off bedroom, and I can adjust the brightness on the light bulb back and forth. I can turn it on, I can turn it off, and so it's just integrated. And some people, they can integrate their home security system. So like the astronaut, she can lock her front doors, and the more things you do with it, the more security holes you open up possibly in your life. So could a hacker log into my network and start turning my lights on and off? Yes. Could a hacker possibly log into the light bulb and get into the rest of my network possibly that way? Yes, it's a possibility. It's very, very small, but it's a possible. It's a danger, and anything you do is a danger, right? What was it? Lord of the Rings, and when Frodo, it's a dangerous game walking out your front door, Frodo. You never know where your feet are going to go, you know, what's going to happen to you. So everything's a risk. This one is a risk I decided to take. But at the same time, I've made sure that I don't have my credit cards or anything linked with my Google account. And I don't really have much security-wise on my Google account. So I'm not overly concerned. But this video right here is talking about how Google Assistant is better than Siri. And in some ways, it talks about how it's better and how it's worse and how we have to learn how to communicate with it to get the answers that we want. So let's go ahead and let's pop this thing through, and it's just pretty quick.
Yo guys, Jonathan here. Hope you guys are doing amazing. Today was Google I.O. 2018, and even though we really didn't see any new hardware, the Google Assistant has been kicking Siri's ass for quite some time now. But after today, it's almost like Google Assistant is playing games with Apple at this point, like it's not even fair. For starters, Google's debuting 6 brand new voices to Google Assistant, one of them being John freaking Legend. Yes, let that sit in for a second. John Legend is going to be a Google Assistant voice. Kind of crazy.
You can find me on all kinds of devices, phones, Google Homes, and if I'm lucky,
in your heart.
Set my wake up alarm for 7 a.m. Good morning. So I'm kind of on the fence of whether this is awesome or kind of weird. Let me know what you guys think with the comment down below. At the very least, John Legend is getting that Google money. But I think the better question is, if you could have any voice on this planet be your Google Assistant, which would it be and why? Now for sure, the craziest thing shown off today was Google Duplex, which takes AI to an almost eerie, scary, but also awesome at the same time kind of level. Google Assistant in the background will make a call, act like a human, interact with a real human to get the task done for you. Just listen to this.
How can I help you?
Hi, I'm calling to book a woman's haircut for a client. I'm looking for something on May 3rd.
Sure, give me 1 second.
Mm-hmm.
Sure, what time are you looking for around?
At 12 p.m.
We do not have a 12 p.m. available. The closest we have to that is a 1:15.
Do you have anything between 10 a.m. and 12 p.m.?
Depending on what service she would like, what service is she looking for?
Just a woman's haircut for now.
Okay, we have a 10 o'clock.
10 a.m. is fine.
Okay, what's her first name?
The first name is Lisa.
Okay, perfect. So I will see Lisa at 10 o'clock on May 3rd.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Great. Have a great day. Bye.
Yeah, that's kind of weird, but also, again, awesome at the same time. Again, keep in mind, this is the best case scenario. There are probably tons of disasters, but the fact that technology is this far is crazy. Google did say, though, we won't see this in its full form anytime soon, which makes sense. It seems really complicated, and there's probably tons of bugs and complications they got to get through first. Rather, something we may see sooner than later is, say, for example, a store has a different holiday hour. Instead of thousands of people calling that store at once, Google will make that call, update the information for you so you never have to make a call. Either way, though, I've never seen something so awesome and scary at the same time. The robot sounds like a human down to saying ums. Like, that's kind of weird. And I don't know where you guys stand. Do you guys like this, or is it the first step to robots taking over the world? Now, from there, Google is rolling out what they are calling continued conversations. So instead of having to say, hey, over and over again, you say it once, and then I'll let you keep a natural flowing conversation until it makes sense to stop.
Sure, here's the Golden State Warriors game on YouTube TV and turning the popcorn maker on.
Oh, and can you dim the lights in the family room and in the kitchen?
Sure, dimming the lights in the family room and in the kitchen.
Now, it is worth noting that Alexa and Amazon already has this feature, but it's obviously more prevalent on smart home devices, whereas this is more advantageous on smartphones, and then obviously it will trickle down to Google Home devices as well. From there, though, what blows the pants off Siri is Google Assistant will now be able to handle multiple actions, meaning you can ask multiple things at the same time. So, for example, hey, who was the governor of California when Kevin Durant was drafted, and what team drafted him?
Arnold Schwarzenegger was the governor in 2007. Kevin Durant was drafted by the Seattle Supersonics.
That's pretty neat.
Now, just for fun, if I went ahead and asked Siri that, who was the governor of California when Kevin Durant was drafted and who drafted him?
Checking out California. Which athlete? Daniel Scott. Brendan Smith, Michael Saffel, Padasi Powdasi, Gavin Reinwald, Jeremiah Hawkins.
This list is like forever long. So not only was that a massive fail, you can see what Google is doing is freaking really cool. Now, beyond just some cool features, Google Assistant is also getting a massive overhaul where it's designed to take up the full screen. I gotta say, it looks really clean. From there, Google's also working with various food chains so you can actually make and place to pick up orders with your phone. So if that's huge in your day-to-day, it just got easier with Google Assistant.
Hello, welcome back to Starbucks. That's one tall, non-fat latte with caramel drizzle. Anything else?
So no thanks.
And are you picking that up at the usual place?
So I'm gonna tap yes.
Okay, your order's in. See you soon.
Yeah.
One of the smaller but really cool features that I think is overlooked today at Google I/O is they're calling Pretty Please, which will teach kids to say pretty please, thank you, give them some manners instead of demanding things from their virtual assistant. Make me a damn sandwich.
There's no need for that.
Pretty please. I know it might seem silly, but you gotta think about it. A lot of these kids, they grow up interacting with smartphones, with tablets, with smart home devices, so that might translate over into the real world when they don't deal with people the best proper way. Overall though, really freaking impressive stuff from Google today. Super excited for the Pixel 3 coming out later this year. Also, the Android P beta is available. Details on how you can install it is down below. Thank you guys very much for watching. Hopefully you enjoyed the video.
So Google Assistant's getting stronger every day. You know, as part of the AI.
You guys, Jonathan here. Hope you guys are doing amazing today.
It's something we're going to have to be living with. And it's not just Google. I mean, we're talking about search engines in general, but Google Assistant is part of Google, and it's a great way to search for things, you know, hands-free. And it does give good, you know, good results. Maybe not as good as just typing it in. Just depends on how, if you tell it the right things to search for, right? It just depends on how you do. If the problem's between the keyboard and the chair, more now than it used to be between the keyboard and the servers in California, probably. You know, I like to toss jokes in here like this one where you can't find it on Google and the library's closed, you're kind of toast, right? So speaking of things that we have available at the Newton Public Library, we've got searchable databases like the Legal Services Free, the Auto Repair Reference Center, Novelist, Small Business Reference Center, Learning Express, Mango, National Geographic Magazine. You can just go through and you can search all of them. Then there's the state databases like LexisNexis, to where you have access to powerful results, 80 million public and private companies, legal resources, so law journals, financials, all sorts of things on the LexisNexis. From the state library, you've got skywayslib.kansas for the history population kind of things of Kansas. Masterfile Premier is search popular magazines, academic search premier, professional level journals, kind of white pages kind of stuff, consumer search reports, you know, if you're searching for furnaces. We've got Kansas Legal Service free forms. When was the last time that you updated your last will and testament? You know, you can go through and fill those out, and you have to print it, and then you still have to take it to have it stamped, you know, to make it official. But librariespot.com for reference desk tools, genealogy from the state. We got health, we got the Mayo Clinic and PubMD, WebMD, got automotive that are not necessarily state databases, the Kelley Blue Book, NADA, non-local books. You can search the entire card catalog. You can do interlibrary loan requests for books out of state. EBSCO databases are just massive out there. Skills training, you got the Learning Library. You got GFC Learn Free. If you're doing search for, say, like the images that I've put through here, you might have noticed the little web links and how I've documented it. You can find these images in the Creative Commons, doing a Creative Commons search or search.creativecommons.org. a lot of ways to find free images that are, you know, legal to use. Then you've got Flickr has a bunch of Creative Commons in their advanced search page, Wikimedia Commons, Search Vault, Google Images, Search Vault, or Creative Commons search. One man can change the world, but you'll need a very big diaper. I don't know. He just had a guru on it and going through search gurus. It seemed like it was fun to pop in there. So gfclearnfree.org is a tool that we have access to everybody in the world. You don't have to worry about having to put your library card in there. Click on math or reading or technology, and here's kind of the new look of the page. I think it's an upgrade. But you can do the works keys stuff, which apparently is almost as important as the ACT these days. But you can do your ACT, your ASVAB, and your GED and everything through here. Kansas Digital Books Lending. You've got kslibinfo/digitalbooks. They'll give you access to all the ways that you can check out ebooks, whether that be through the 3M Cloud or Freeding or e-ink or e-inky. You want to, you know, go through and make sure that you've done all your operating system updates. The mobile apps are generally for Android or Kindle Fire or iOS. Some of it's for Chromebooks. There are some Kindle e-readers that is not capable, you know, the black and white ones that can't really load apps. But we've got other things like Tumble Books and One Click Digital and Project Gutenberg. This is not letting with the state, but Project Gutenberg, it's gorgeous, right? Gutenberg was the guy that came up with the printing press and made it so that the Bibles are accessible to everybody who wants them at a decent price, and so that knowledge is more available to the world than ever right now, right? So Project Gutenberg is an online version of the same thing, to where you can scan your own book as long as you own the copyright and everything to it, and they will upload it so that the world has access to read it. You don't have to log in. You don't have to pay a monthly fee. When you download something, it's yours. It's like in PDF format. So you can put it on your phone. You can put it on your computer. You own it. You don't have to worry about turning it back in. 58,000 titles and more, just constantly growing. Time for a little bit of levity. You know what? Downtown, there's a guy called a reference librarian. Ask him any question, and he knows it. If he doesn't know it, he looks it up for you for free. Ask him why the whole world doesn't know about it. He's looking it up. Boom, boom. So libraries, right? They're changing the way that we search. Google's changing the way that we search, and we are taking in what's available to everyone and making it easier to use, right? So at your local library, you can ask somebody, say you have trouble searching for something, they can help you out with it. They're becoming more than just book repositories. They're becoming community centers, or they were before COVID. Now they're back to being book repositories because there's not a lot of classes like this where we can meet face to face anymore. To where, as soon as things open back up, people can come in here and they can sit with me and argue with me and ask questions with me. I'm looking forward to it. Geekthelibrary.org is one group that to where you can talk about what you're interested in. Say maybe it's amateur radio, ham radio, right? And you can find another group in there, and make it at your library.org is one way that people who make makers groups can join in with their local library, to where, say you made a bookshelf and you're really proud of it, take a picture of it, join your group, find a group online and share it. We here in Newton, we have Make Harvey, which is a Facebook group as well, but we used to meet and we would share what projects we're working on. Right now there's a whole lot of gardening pictures, and we're thinking about doing a seed library here coming in pretty soon, to where we've got an old card catalog. People can bring in seeds and we can share them with other people, and looking forward to building community through that. So new director, new projects. It's great. Good times. So there's other ways you can search for things. You can search in the deep web, right? It's kind of a mysterious place that's not part of the search engines. If not discoverable by other means, sometimes it's password protected, usually dynamic pages inside of encrypted network. Biggest weakness of the deep web is its biggest strength. It's kind of hard to find anything. So it's huge also because a lot of it's like corporations that are, you know, behind their own walls, right? So 4% of material online is surface web stuff that you can search for. The other 96% is behind barriers. So that's why the deep web is such a big thing, because it is a big thing. So you look at that 4%, you've got Facebook and Tumblr and Reddit. And if you have below the deep web, you've got access to like 4chan and 7chan and 2chan, and you're kind of bored if you're doing that. But if you use a proxy or are okay with saying hi to the FBI, you can have access to the Onion and all sorts of things that you know, that are hidden on the internet. Dark web is a collection of thousands of websites that use anonymity tools like Tor to hide their IP address, while it's famously being used for black market drug sales and child pornography. Dark web also allows anonymous whistleblowers to protect users from surveillance and censorship. Research all the things. Come to your library and help us help you find what it is you're really interested in. Didn't quite make it to 7:30. So if you have any questions, looks like the only one that's really logged in right now is Keith. And I can ask him to unmute. If you have any questions, now's the time to ask. I might have lost you. Well, either way, I'm
not good. What was that source on ebooks again?
Oh my goodness. Let's take you to our web page. NewtonPLKS.org is our website. And from there, you can have access to all the huge list of ebooks, e-videos, and e-music. So we'll go to resources and ebooks, e-videos, e-music. And so we've got all sorts of the free stuff down here, right? And then there's the Sunflower e-library, which you log into. You click on that and you log into the Overdrive system or Libby. Both kind of work the same database of books. And you log in with usernames, your library card number. Password is the last four of your phone number, unless you might have changed it. But then you have access to just thousands of, it's a coalition of small libraries who we buy books together, and we have access to other people's books so that we don't have to buy 3 million books just start, right? So we have access to all these other books through the Sunflower e-library. Hoopla is a service to where we pay a certain amount. You have access to a certain number of books per month, and they tend to be the newer titles, say the Oprah favorite book month kind of books. Then we've got the state library stuff where you did the digital book e-lending link. And this one you log into with your state library card, which is different from your Newton Public Library card. Just come on in, show us your driver's license, and we'll help you out setting up a state library card. And so that's how you'll have access to the RB Digital and Cloud Library, e-Inky, Freeding, and all sorts of different things. And that's through the state. So the reason you want to have access to both Sunflower e-library and the state library, cloud library, is that we buy different books. So say you want The Stand and by Stephen King, right? You search for it in the state library's cloud library and it's not there, okay? Say you search for it in the Sunflower e-library, sometimes it'll be there. That particular one, I think they only had it in German for some reason, but I found it on Amazon Audible. But so there's lots of different ways to do reading. You know, you've got your ebooks, you got your audio books, you've got your ones that are combination to where you can read it while you're listening to it, ones that are performed by highly paid performance engineers. Sometimes it's like, I think I missed over this one. LibriVox. LibriVox is like Gutenberg, to where they do free public domain audiobooks instead of just ebooks. So these are performers that are looking to get into the industry. So you might click on it, short poetry collection, and start listening to it. And you might hear somebody hiccuping or a cat meowing or police sirens in the background. It's not necessarily going to be a professional performance. Usually it's individuals, and you can volunteer. You can, you know, learn the craft, and they'll teach you more about how to perform audiobooks. But that's how these get in here, is they're all old books. They're beyond the copyright laws.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much. It's been a good program.
Well, thank you very much. Well, I'm going to go ahead and end the presentation and have a nice month, and we've got another class next month.
Okay, thank you.